To really know what it's like to live in an overpopulated place, watch the daily vigil for the municipal water tanker truck here in Delhi's Vasant Kunj or thousands of similar neighborhoods across urban India.
By 12 o'clock?
Chanda lives in an illegal settlement here in this city of 16 million and growing. On this day, she left her job as a daily laborer mid-morning, hoping to run back and collect some water. Anxious to return to work, she kept checking on the tanker's arrival time.
By 4 o'clock.
Exactly when the truck arrives is anyone's guess. Every day, these women say they spend 4 hours, their children often miss school, just waiting for the only source of water for their daily consumption and for sanitation. There are no working toilets here.
We have to go out in the open. There's a forested area across the street. It's really humiliating. There are men sitting around there, and the women are afraid to go there. We go in groups.
Jyoti Sharma, a conservation activist who runs a small aid agency, says the city is simply overwhelmed.
Every year, we get an additional 0.5 to 0.7 million people. That's the net addition to the city.
700,000 people every year.
700,000 people, yes. A majority of this growth is of people who are poor, and they typically come and settle in these kind of settlements. Only 27% of the city is actually a planned city. The rest of it has just grown like this. And you cannot stop them from coming because that's the only place they will get some livelihood from.
Sharma lives in a middle-class enclave behind a wall but right across the street from the slum. When it comes to water supply, they're better off here but hardly well off.
We get water 45 minutes in the morning and that's it.
From the city?
Yes, that's it. So in 45 minutes, you stock up on however much water you can. These are all pipelines laid by the people themselves. And these pipelines then go to online motors. So when they know the time when the water is released into the pipeline system. So at that time, people switch on these motors. And these motors suck water from the pipelines into these storage tanks. And then sometime during the day, they have another motor which pumps this up to
the rooftop.
And from there, they get their supply of water whenever they want.
It's an elaborate, expensive system to work around the anemic municipal water supply. And ironically, the water they get may well be unsafe.
The motors, they actually create a suction vacuum. So if there is no water in the pipeline, that any crack in the pipe will allow sewage or dirty water to get into the pipelines. And that actually becomes a big problem, cause for diseases here.
In her own kitchen, Sharma has a filtration system and, like other middle-class Indians, she can buy her way to a secure water supply. Across the street, meanwhile, residents had to wait until the next day for the next water tanker. Sharma says Delhi's water situation is ripe for conflict.
Now, the day this tanker stops coming, I'm sure that just to feed their children, they will come there and they'll break into water tanks. And neither from the security point of view nor from the humanity point of view, we won't be able to stop them. So if the water wars happen, they will happen in places like this. Populations are dense, resources are dwindling, aspirations are high. This is where the conflict will happen.
To make matters worse, groundwater supplies are also dwindling. The city pipes fresh water in from dams as far away as 200 miles. It's simply unsustainable, given not just population, but also economic growth in India, says Ashok Jatli, a scholar at the Environmental Research Institute in Delhi.
It's not just the pressure of numbers. As you have a rate of growth of 8%, 9%, 10%, your lifestyle changes. Your diet is different. You have showers and swimming pools and all that sort of thing, you know. So the whole lifestyle changes, and that results in increased per capita consumption of water. That also needs to be attended to.
However, he says there's been little enthusiasm for addressing water issues or for passing overall water policies. He says it's particularly true of India's agriculture sector, which consumes 80% of the country's fresh water supply. Half of it goes to waste. The water table is declining rapidly in the breadbasket state of Punjab, for example, severely imperiling underground aquifers and ultimately food production itself.
For Punjab's farmers, the water flows freely and it flows for free. Submersible pumps are subsidized by the government, which also provides electricity and water at no charge to farmers, giving them virtually no incentive to conserve.
The farmer lobby is very powerful, and electorally in India, and therefore you have the politics of populism, which encourages inefficient water management and inefficient water utilization. It's a very emotive and political issue.
So is the issue of population control, even though fewer people would seem like a solution to dwindling resources. To begin, Ashish Bose says economics determine family size, especially in poor families where children are a sort of retirement plan.
In India, we don't have social security for all elderly people, so only they have to rely on children.
Bose, who's one of India's leading demographers, says the government of Indira Gandhi launched family planning programs in the 1970s that were widely perceived as coercive, leading to her government's defeat at the ballot box. It was a huge setback to any concerted government family planning program. And yet, even as the growing population makes life harder and harder, Bose says the problem is rarely tackled head-on.
They concede that there are too many people, and that is why we are suffering. Everywhere we go, there's a long queue. If you go to a free health, for example, if you have an emergency, and then say you come after 3 days, because there are so many other people in line.
Come after 3 days in an emergency?
Yes. So then he has to go to a private doctor, shell out money, borrow money from his friends, and then go to a private doctor. So they realize, but then they say, government should have done enough for us by way of developing good hospitals for the poor. They blame the government for the slow development.
And he says India's only option is development. Improving people's economic security will reduce family size.
In one of my lectures, I said that development is the best contraceptive. I still believe so.
In fact, India has one of the world's fastest rates of development, and family sizes are declining. The population is projected to stabilize by about 2050. But by then, India will be the world's most populous nation at 1.6 billion.